research and video manufacturing facility. This is Pastor Mike, and I'm online, and I'm live with you today. This is the talk show Hell Hates. The more you listen, the more you know why. I got a couple of prayer requests I'm going to start out with today. One of them is for a family member of mine. My aunt Mary Jo, she and my uncle Juan live down in Atlanta, Georgia, and good Christian family, love them dearly. They started requesting some books that I wrote here while, you know, by divine order in King James Code. And Uncle Juan said he just couldn't get enough of it. So we put them on our watchers list. They get our packets every month and just eat the stuff up. And Aunt Mary Jo has just always been a good student of Bible prophecy and so on. But anyway, she just found out that she has stomach cancer. And my mom called me this morning and let me know, and my mom's pretty tore up about it. And so anyway, if you would pray for Aunt Mary Jo and Uncle Juan down in Atlanta, Georgia, I would appreciate it. I have another prayer request, and I'm assuming, and I've sent word to who sent this, and asked them if I could talk about this online just briefly. I haven't heard anything back yet. I'm not going to mention names, and I'm not going to get too specific. As this relates to someone's medical condition, and in this particular case, it has to do with mental health. And I'm bringing this up for a reason. But anyway, this lady writes in that she wants us to pray for her and her husband, but primarily for her husband. He has been diagnosed with a mild mental disorder. Now, I believe with all my heart that my brain is an organ of my body, like my heart, my liver, my lungs, my mucous membranes, my thyroid glands, my pinky toe. It is a member of my body, and as such is capable of malfunctioning. And I say this because there's a lot that goes around on the internet. Some of it well-meaning, don't get me wrong. But there's information that gets transmitted across the World Wide Web that places every mental disorder under the "you have a devil" position. In other words, anybody that has, I was sent an email several years ago by a lady who was saying something about she knows someone or had heard about someone with Tourette's. And there are different varying, you know, cases of Tourette's. Some of them are pretty severe, and these people will talk normal for about 2 or 3 minutes and then curse and bark. And she asked me, doesn't that activity indicate that these people have devils? And I wrote back to her and I said, ma'am, my son, Matthew, has Tourette's. He does not have this advanced form of it. But we noticed that he was making certain throat sounds and so on. A lot of throat clearing. I had a good friend in Bible college that had Tourette's, and he wanted a career in radio broadcasting and just wasn't able to pull it off. But my son was diagnosed with Tourette's years ago as a child, and to this day, even as an adult, he just does a lot of throat clearing and just little things like that. It's nothing big. He doesn't curse. He doesn't, there's no guttural sounds coming out of him and things like that. It's just something, there's something there. Don't know what it is. Some people stutter. Moses probably did. He was hard of speech. And God said, with stammering lips and another tongue will I speak to this people. There are people who suffer from clinical, some form of biological depression. There are some people who suffer with schizophrenia. We have somebody in our church that does. We have the guys that come from the group home here in Jefferson County. They have varying forms of mental disorders. Some of them are a result of damage, you know, done by an accident or something like that, or something from birth. But there are people out there on the internet that would have you believe that, number one, any kind of mental disorder is a demon. And number two, any treatment of anything like that just opens you to the world of demonic. I don't believe that. I don't believe it for a minute. If anything, the Bible teaches us as Christians to comfort the feeble-minded. And the word feeble means that there is a weakness or some sort of malady there that these people can't help. And I've seen quote unquote Christians basically just blast people that they're not living for God right, or they're not serving God enough, or obviously there's sin in their life and they won't live right, and that's why they're depressed all the time. Now I understand. I get it. There are people who have devils in them. There's no doubt in my mind about that. There are people who are depressed because they're carrying a load of sin that they won't get rid of. They've gotten themselves in a position to where they can't deal with life because of how they lived it. But I have several people in this church that suffer from various feebleness, weaknesses in their mind. And I don't belittle them. I'm not constantly accusing them that they're not living right, they're not serving God right because of it. I don't think Christians ought to do that. Now, having said that, and I don't think that psychiatry, psychology, things like that have all the answers. I don't think that they're always wrong either. I don't think that. The brain is a very, very complex piece of equipment that God gave to us. And how many things have to go wrong on your computer before your computer just doesn't work very well? If you've got one of the circuits bad on the circuit board, there's going to be problems. It's the same way with the human brain. Very, very complicated organism that God gave us in our head that basically operates and functions most of what goes on in this body, including our outward demeanor and our behavior. And if there's a wire shorted out, synapses are not firing or being triggered the right way, or some sort of brain damage or something like that, that's going to be exhibited in their behavior. That's just how it is. And having said that, and this is the what I wrote back to this lady concerning her husband, and she said it gets pretty serious at times. And I told her, I said, there is a spiritual aspect to this. And you guys listen to this, okay? This is for anyone who suffers or think that they might be suffering chronic depression. There's schizophrenia. I have experience with people who had, the old form of it was called multiple personalities. The new word for it is multiple dissociative identity disorder. And one of the persons that I have known who I found out had dissociative identity disorder, had multiple personalities, this poor young lady was molested not only by her own mother, but by every guy that came into that house for years. And her brain, in that formative, from 5 years old on, her brain just compartmentalized different aspects of the things that you and I take for granted every day. There is a spiritual aspect to that. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying, again, I don't think science and psychology has all the answers, or psychiatry. Because we know that when we are weak, we know that wolves and lion packs and all of those predatory animals that hunt together, we know that they always seek after the weak first. The easy kill. And those who have any kind of weakness, be it emotional, be it a sin weakness, we know those devils that our beasts are going to go after them in that weakness. There's something I found out the other day. I never knew this. We sit around my office sometime before church, like on Wednesday night, Sunday afternoon, drink coffee and cut up a little bit, and I'll try to find something funny on YouTube to watch. And we watched a guy skinning a wild boar. None of us have ever skinned a wild boar before. This guy hunted and killed, it was down in Texas, a wild boar, and they are an increasing problem. Texas, Arkansas, southern Missouri, places like that. So he was showing how to skin it easily, get the meat out of it. I did not know that these wild pigs, he said, you got to cut around this shield area. These things, right around this area here, they've got this hard, bony shield built into their skin. And if you know how wild boars act, they don't get up and throw knives at you. They run right after you with tusks and chest. And that's their protection right there. So if you're going to try to shoot, stab, bow and arrow a wild pig, stay away from the shield area, because it may not be effective. And here's my point. All of us have shield areas. We've got areas that we are strong in. I never wanted to smoke a cigarette. Somebody, when I was in high school playing tuba, and I played it very well, somebody put an unlit cigarette down inside the bell, this big area of the tuba, down inside there. I don't know who it was, don't know why they did it. But I remember going to band practice, and I was playing, and every time I would breathe in, I would get this taste, and I'd go, ugh, what is that? And I kept tasting it. Finally, a few weeks later, yeah, it took me a while, I took the bell off and turned that tuba upside down, and this unlit cigarette came rolling out, and I'm going, that's why. Ugh. Who puts those things in their mouths? You can't. The devil knows he can't say, hey, Mike, want to smoke? Come on, you know you want it. No, I don't. It's stupid. Okay. I've got shield areas. I've got weak areas. You do too. My shield areas may not be yours. Yours may not be mine. My weak areas may not be yours. Yours may not be mine, but we've got them. And I'm telling you, and I told this lady, here's your job. Number one, it's serious enough right now that somebody professional needs to get involved in this man's life before something happens. And number two, God can use this woman in such a way as she could be the strong and mighty shield on behalf of her husband. Now, you ladies and you husbands and you moms and dads, you take this. You take it and run with it. Sometimes we can't protect ourselves. The whole thing of being in a relationship with someone, be it a brother, sister, friends, good friends, Christian brethren, husbands, wives, parents, is that we protect those who cannot protect themselves. And especially you godly ladies, there's no reason in the world why a devil could come within 20 miles of your house. Okay? All it takes is a praying heart, a crying eye, and a great big King James Bible out, open, and read daily. Sometimes just read it out loud so every devil in a room can hear it. All right? Remember, the beasts, like the dragon, the serpent, the devil, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Isn't that what the Bible says? What did Jesus do? He quoted scripture and the devil left. I can't hear this anymore. He cannot handle the word of God. And God put a fear in beasts of the man. So husbands, wives, moms, dads, grandparents, even you children, pastors, deacons, Sunday school teachers, just church people. Be a shield for your church or your family, your neighbors. Ladies, you know your husband wrestles with issues. He can't talk about it. He doesn't want to deal with it. You know he does. Why don't you stand strong for him and be a shield for him? Lift him up. Intercessory prayer, praying for him night and day. Crying your eyes out before God. Getting that Bible out and reading it. You don't even have to read it in his presence. Just read it. God will honor that book. And devils, they can't handle the blood. Remember the destroying angel in the Passover? When he saw the blood, didn't go in the house. When the devil heard the word of God three times, I'm out of here. I can't handle that stuff. And I'm just saying, be strong for people that cannot be strong for themselves. Don't go around. Let's not bayonet the wounded in the house of God. Somebody say amen. All right. I was trying to do an awful lot this morning and trying to answer some old emails. There's no way I can get to all of them. People, thank you so much for the amount of emails that you send, the information that you send, PastorMikeOnline@gmail.com. I get good stuff there. And a lot of it, if I'm not able to pass it along here on this program, then I will put it at Facebook.com/PastorMikeOnline, and that is right here, right there in your screen. And that's it. Some of the articles that I talked about on Tuesday are there now. Some of the things, there's no way I can get to all of it today because there's just, my head's just rattling with some things I've just been thinking about. I watched a video and I would play it for you, but YouTube would flag the entire internet if I played this thing. That's how YouTube is now. Hi, YouTube, sorry. Okay. But you are just a little over picky on this like copyright thing, all right? I tweeted it. So on most of our websites, there is our Twitter section. You can follow our ministry on Twitter. Just about everything I do goes on Twitter. And I put it on Facebook.com/PastorMikeOnline. You've got to watch this. I don't say that to everything. And this is not some guy with a 3.5-hour lecture about Hillary Clinton becoming an alien reptilian shapeshifter, okay? This is 11, 12, 13 minutes, something like that. And it's done in sort of a graphic illustrative form, a cartoon form. Not like a Mickey Mouse or Bugs Bunny cartoon form, but it graphically, I like this kind of stuff. It makes what's going on in science very simple to understand. And it's explaining it using pictures that we all like pictures, and it's doing that. And it's talking about the CRISPR DNA editing system and what it's capable. And I watch this thing and I'm going, these people are dead on. And at one point I'm going, I think some of those guys been listening to Pastor Mike online is what I think. Because at one point they were talking about the future of CRISPR, and this graphic came up of Kim Jong-un stuffing himself with food, getting fat, using CRISPR to alter all of the people in North Korea so that they are totally submissive subjects to the supreme god of North Korea. And that's what he considers himself as. That's what his dad did. That's what his grandfather did, who all died. They all died. How can you be a god and then just, what, disappear, die? But anyway, and then they talked about how he might make super soldiers out of it. And I went, hold on a minute. I was talking about that here, like, I don't know, 6-8 months ago, a year ago, maybe. Somebody's listening to Pastor Mike online is what I think. Or it just stands to reason that in the, we are, listen, right now, people, we are in a new age. We are in it. Now, we are in the age that I know I was warning about since 2009, First Watchman. I know that others of you have been seeing it coming, have been sort of watchmen on the wall, sharing the information that you had with other people. The age that we warned about, we're in it right now. It's like back in the 50s. Yet godly men standing behind pulpits, pounding the daylights out of those wooden desks, telling everybody, don't let your kids listen to Elvis Presley and rock and roll music. It's going to turn this nation into a nation of savages. It's going to turn our children into whoremongers. They're going to be drunkards. They're going to be addicted to drugs. And we entered that very age that those preachers warned about. They preached it. Nobody listened. So now we're in the age right now. We are in the era. I don't know what to, I don't know how to call it. We've had the three-parent baby born. We have the Swedes and the Chinese experimenting with human embryos, which means human baby humans, using CRISPR, healthy ones, healthy babies, using the CRISPR DNA editing system to rewrite part of their genetic code so that whatever they were designed by God to be, man put a stop to it and said, oh, no, you don't, God. We found, listen now, listen to all you pastors and to all you you critics of a perfect Bible. It's like the CRISPR scientists, it's like they all went to your church and they heard you for years tell everybody that their Bible had mistakes in it and that they couldn't trust it. The minister had spent years studying the Greek and the Hebrew language. He had a master's of divinity, specializing in Old and New Testament original manuscripts. Doctor of philosophy when it comes to theology. Scouring the Vaticanus and Sinaiticus documents. Reading the Nestle-Aland Greek text where they had a Jesuit priest sitting on the committee making sure that the right corrections were made in the Greek text. Scoured these documents, then went to the Bible that everybody had, primarily a King James. And as he delivers his sermon from Sunday to Sunday, constantly feeding to the people that their Bible had a small error in it. Just a little one. It's no big deal. Don't worry about it. But I will correct the error, and I will tell you what God really wanted to say. But the Bible and the way it was translated and the way it was copied prohibits God from telling you directly what he wants you to know. You now have to get it from the smart guy who knows that there are mistakes. I've got a friend. I consider the man a friend and a brother. He was in the ministry at one time, pastored a church, raised his children well, had good philosophies, good standards, always preached out of a King James. But we began to talk about it, and he said, Mike, I know there's errors in the King James. I know there are. And I don't know if I've ever convinced him otherwise. But he believed that here and there and little places over here and words over here doesn't really mean that. And this word here, well, in the original Greek text, this word had one letter added to it later on, and that changed the entire meaning and so on. And they give you all these things. But it's like the genetic scientist sat in church, listened to the preachers correct God's word, and then took that same philosophy and said, we found errors in God's book, DNA. And we are going to fix them. We're going to change them. We're going to rewrite. Listen to this now. Listen. We are going to rewrite prophecy is what we're going to do. Let me show you something. I didn't plan on this today. Let me show you something. I don't know what made me look at it. I'm going to try to put this up on the screen here. And so you can see it with the power that I have with Wirecast. Let me switch Bibles here. This is blueletterbible.org, and I use it as a racehorse. Nah, not a racehorse. A resource. Sorry. Use it as a resource to find what other translations say. I'll tell you what I'll do. Let's go to King James first, and we'll go to Daniel. And we'll go to Daniel chapter 2. We'll just hit Daniel chapter 2. And you can just go down the whole chapter, Daniel chapter 2, in the King James. Now, we know that in the King James, right here, this verse right here, that whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of man. Come on, music here. By the way, I found out that you can go to Walmart and get an entire almost 2-quart jug of Gold Peak tea for $2. And the little bottles are $1.50 a piece at the gas station. Yeah. Anyway, we know that fourth kingdom. We know from the Bible. We know that fourth kingdom is not a kingdom of this world. We know it. We know principalities and powers and rulers of darkness and spiritual wickedness in high places. That's who that fourth kingdom is. And it specifically says that they are going to mingle themselves with the seed of men. That we know now what that is. We know that a reference to the word seed in your King James Bible is always a reference to DNA. We know that. What was the purpose of the ark in Genesis? To preserve seed. Preserve DNA. How do you do that? Put the animals on the ark that are carrying the seed. When the flood's over, let them back out. They'll do what animals do. They'll procreate and pass that seed along. So we know that seed deals with DNA. Now, here's something that I did because I wanted to check it. You go to tools and you can get, this would be Old Testament. So actually this is one of the few parts in the Bible, in the Old Testament, that's not Hebrew. It's Aramaic, which is like the first cousin of Hebrew. Okay, I think. And I don't have to click on these verses or these Strong's letters. You can. You get the word zera here, and it means seed or offspring. Okay? DNA is what it means. Okay? So the language literally says, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. Okay? It's what it says. So now let's do this same thing. Daniel 2, but we're going to look in the New International Version. I never did this before. Never did it. And when I saw it the other day, I went, somebody's trying to cover something up here. Somebody's trying to change something or hide it. Daniel 2, verse 43 in the NIV. And just as you saw the iron mixed with baked clay, so the people will be a mixture and will not remain united any more than iron mixes with clay. They took it out. They covered it up. They hid it. See if I can go. Yeah, next chapter. You guys know this. Daniel 3:25. Here's Nebuchadnezzar. Neb says, look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed. And the fourth looks like a son of the gods. Something's not right, people. What they're wanting to do with CRISPR editing is alter prophecy. Because remember, DNA is a prophetic book. It has in it details of things that have not happened yet, but are going to happen. And the machine that we were kind of talking about this on Tuesday, the machine that does this, RNA polymerase, acts just like Jesus does when it comes to transcribing the word, opening the book of DNA, unsealing it, reading it, fulfilling it. It is everything that Jesus is and represents. And what was written aforetime, which means in the past, in the Old Testament, was written because it is going to be fulfilled one of these days. And what's written in your DNA, there are things probably in you that are contained in your DNA. They have not popped up yet. They're not there yet. But they're going to be. And so the genetic scientists, the CRISPR geniuses, Monsanto now getting into the CRISPR editing business, they're doing one thing and they're able to do it extremely easily, quickly, inexpensively, and permanently. The one thing that they're doing very, very well is that they are altering the future They're creating a new order, a new era. Drudge Report yesterday had on its cover the little star child from 2001 Space Odyssey. If you've never seen that, or you can Google the image. And it's basically this child born in space floating toward the Earth as if it was being offered to the Earth. Arthur C. Clarke was, whew, wow. And the headline was, baby born, we are now in a new era. Child born with three parents. So this is not, we're not waiting for this to happen. We're not waiting for the day. We're not thinking now that, oh, this will never happen. That's that science fiction right-wing conspiracy stuff you guys sit and watch on YouTube all the time. It's never going to happen. It happened. It's been warned about, it's been talked about, and now we're in that era. We're in the era of the new humans. A new breed, a new type of humanity has been born, has been initiated. A new order of the ages, a new world order has been born. And we're now in it. And it's only the beginning. It won't stop with babies with three parents. They'll have four, five, six, seven. Who knows? A child would be born that would have 72 parents. Why do I say that number? Why that particular number? Turn to Genesis 10. This is one of the things years ago that I counted. I went through the Bible just counting. If I see a list of something, I count it. I want to know how many's in that list. Okay? And I counted years ago and wrote it in one of the books, either by divine order or the King James Code. And I said, in Genesis 10, you have a 10's a number for dominion. If you multiply 10 times itself three times, you get 1,000. That's millennial reign. 10 times 10 times 10. And, we know the Lord during that time in the 1,000 years is going to rule over all the families of the earth. All the families of the earth are listed in Genesis chapter 10, and there are 70 of them in there. And I was really proud of myself for capturing that number. 70, that's perfect, man. It's going to be at the 7th millennium. It's going to be 1,000 years, and that's 7 times 10. And somebody wrote me an email. He said, Pastor, we was reading your book, and you said 70 in Genesis 10, but we counted differently. And of course, well, obviously you're wrong, because I counted it, and I know. So I thought, yeah, I'm gonna. So I made a document, and I put all of the family names that I found in Genesis chapter 10 in that document, and then I listed each one of them, and I put a number next to them, and yeah, I was wrong. In Genesis 10, there are 72 families listed in Genesis 10. 72 different tribes of peoples on the earth all come from three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. 72. And I haven't even got to this part of the capstone series yet. I get these series started, don't finish them, start another series, don't finish it. But I'll get to it one of these days. The pyramid on the back of the dollar bill that makes up the Great Seal, Manly Hall said, it's got 72 stones in it. It's made of 72 stones, exactly. And I went, oh, wow. I get that. I understand what that is. Those 72 stones represent the 72 families, 72 tribes, 72 nations that are listed in Genesis 10. And it's showing that the one who has that all-seeing eye, the capstone, not the cornerstone, the capstone, he emanates from the 72 families of the earth, the 72 tribes, the 72 types of people on the earth. He comes from all of them. They are his parents, birthed out of them. That's crazy, isn't it? Did you know that? Let's see here. Those of you who live in Dallas, Texas, or you ever go to Dallas, Texas, and you go to Dealey Plaza to see where the shooter stood behind the fence, right? Okay. Go back east to the JFK Memorial. It is what's called a cenotaph, which is a Greek term meaning empty tomb. There is a plaque, all it is. And people, when they put it there, the people of Dallas looked at it and said, that looks stupid. What is that? There's this wall. There's this square fence around this bronze plaque stuck on the ground that says John Fitzgerald Kennedy and all that stuff on there. And there, and then there is this boarded, big, huge wall around this thing that has 72 plaques in it. Exactly. It's a memorial to something, but it's not a memorial to JFK. The National Archives building that has these ancient documents in it has 72 pillars around it. Okay? And I can go on and on and on and on. I've been collecting 72s now for years. But what that means is there is, listen to me, people, there is going to be a child born with 72 parents. We already have phase one done. A child born with three parents. That broke the ice, as it were. That just kind of shifted the entire planet. There is no provision in God's word. Genesis 2 makes it clear. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. That was God's plan. Man just went beyond God's design. He altered it. And then it'll be four. It'll be five. It'll be eight. It'll be 20. There'll be a lab somewhere that, and that's what this cartoon video shows. We're getting into the era of designer babies. And the way they thought it out was genius. First of all, it's all going to be about curing diseases. It's all going to be about that. And it's going to be about preventing diseases. And then it's going to be about, would you like to have bigger muscles? Would you like to have more hair? Would you like to be taller? Would you like to be better looking? Not just, and I'll say this, not just designer babies. Designer humans. Using the gene drive system with the CRISPR editing system makes that when one cell is changed, all the cells get changed throughout the whole body. And I want you to think of the body as being not just the human physical singular body that you possess, but the collective of all human beings on the planet. A gene drive system that transforms, let's see, Revelation chapter 13. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead. You're going to have a gene drive situation where everybody on the earth is going to be transformed, augmented, changed, right down into the level of their genetic code. That's the era that we're in right now. That's the world. We are now officially in the beginnings of the new world order. Here we are, people. Better get your Bible out. Better get your sins confessed. Better get on your knees and be ready to stand in the evil day, because the evil day is on its way. Because it's going to get much, much worse. And you've seen all the movies, right? Where the strong always overcome the weak. That's what's going to happen. Let's get into, let's talk about this for a little bit. DNA transcription. Because when I studied this and kind of figured out what it was, that was, I'm going, that is the coolest thing in the world. Let me just explain it. You have 46 chromosomes in your cells. Wonder how many chromosomes are in tea leaves. Wonder how many chromosomes tea has. That'd be interesting. But you have 46 chromosomes, 23 pairs, which to me is really cool. They're always in pairs. Adam had 23. Eve had 23. They were pairs. And when they joined together, they were paired. That's how it is. God said it's not, listen to this. God said it's not good that the man should be alone. I will make him help, meet for him. And those chromosomes are in pairs. They have mates. In Isaiah, seek ye out the book of the Lord. No one of these shall fail. None shall want her mate. It's just cool. Anyway. And your body has needs. Okay? Mine, you know, well, yours too. You need insulin. But you need other proteins. You need other things built in your body. Because as the cells are dividing and multiplying, some of them are in the process of dying off. Why? Because that's the course. Isaiah 40. All flesh is grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. And every cell in your body dies. Every protein and every building block of the things that in your body, they need new ones. Sometimes with children, it's because they're growing and they need more skin. They need more bones. They need more blood. They need more rambunctiousness or whatever. They need more of that stuff. And your body has to make that stuff. How does it make it? It follows the guidelines and the recipe that's given in the DNA. Here's the process of how it works. The machine, the polymerase machine, RNA. It scours, it's reading through. It's like, Donna, you're going to like this. It's like the RNA polymerase has a copy of the King James Pure Bible Search software. I like that. Because the RNA polymerase is not looking on any given day to read the entire Bible of DNA. If the cells happen to be liver cells, then obviously the RNA polymerase is not going to want to make hair cells, because no one wants a hairy liver. It needs to make liver cells. And so that's what it does. It's reading and looking for the genetic markers that say how to make new liver cells and how to make liver proteins and liver enzymes and all the things that the liver does. It's looking for those instructions. And it's like got the software going, okay, where's the part in the Bible about the liver? Where's that at? Okay. So that's what it does. It's looking for a specific place. Here's Jesus in the synagogue. They give him the scroll of the book. He unrolls the scroll. He opens it. Breaks the seals. Reads a portion of it. Closes. You know, I was going to do this last night. And I didn't do it. I got to show you this. This is one of my happy list things. Okay, since I'm talking about this. You can do this. Go to Luke chapter 4. And let's see here. We need a... What do we need here? We need a calculator. There we go. We need a calculator. Because we're going to add stuff. Okay, so I'm going to put the calculator over here for now. And what we're going to do is, let's read this right here. And he came to Nazareth where he'd been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Esaias, which is Isaiah. And when he opened the book, see it right there. There was delivered to him the book of the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah has 66 chapters. Bible has 66 books. So what Jesus is doing here is he is a sort of a shadow and a type in a small way of the big picture of him in heaven with the book, opening the book, which is your Bible, the Word of God. Here, it's the book of Isaiah. It's a microcosm of the macro. It's a little bit, it's a little picture of the big picture. So he opens the book. That's what RNA polymerase does. It opens the book only at the section where it's going to make a copy of it, transcript it. And he found the place where it was written. He was looking for a certain place in Isaiah. And he read, the Lord, or excuse me, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Then it says, verse 20, and he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister and sat down. He was done. He was the RNA polymerase that found the section of DNA that needed to be transcripted and built. He transcripted it by reading it. He then closed the book because that's what, let me pull this up here. That's what the RNA polymerase does. It opens the book only long enough to read or to transcript a copy of what it needs. And when it's done, it rolls the book back up and closes it to protect it, to preserve it, to seal it, so its contents cannot be defiled or altered. And that's exactly, I mean, that is just so cool. That is exactly what Jesus did right here. He acted out science for you. I loved it. Now watch this. This is what gets me happy. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. You see what he did? He's the RNA polymerase. He opened the DNA, transcripted what he needed, closed the DNA back up, and then built the protein by saying, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Now here's what I like. I hope I remembered this right. I hope I did it right. I'm going to select all the words that Jesus said, just like that. Okay? Down at the bottom here, on the lower, you can't see it. Yeah, maybe you can. Look right above where it says Pastor Mike Online there. There's a total of 57 words selected. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to bring Mr. Calculator in here. We're going to put in 57. We're going to hit plus. Okay. And take Mr. Happy Calculator, move him over here. And then we're going to take these next words that he said to finish the deal. This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. We're going to copy those. We're going to highlight those. And the Bible says, and the software says, that there are 9 words selected there. So we're going to add 9 to that. That, my friends, is cool. 66 words exactly reading from a book with 66 chapters in it that's based on a much larger volume with 66 books in it. And you think that's an accident. You think that that doesn't mean anything. That's just, there are people who are finding stuff like this all the time. And they send me a lot of it. And I'm just going, that is just, okay, that's pretty cool. That's pretty awesome right there. Okay? That Bible, listen, that Bible is right. Now, I don't spend all of my studying time counting patterns in the Bible. I don't do that. A majority of my study is spent reading the text. That, my friends, I mean, if you want to count this stuff, be my guest. Knock yourself out. You guys are finding some awesome stuff. When I first started finding numerical patterns in the Bible, I did spend a ton of time just looking for them. The Holy Ghost kind of put his hand on my shoulder and said, son, slow down a little bit. You're so wrapped up in counting this stuff. You're not doing the most important thing here. You're not reading the verses. You're not reading the Bible. You're just looking at the pictures, almost. Read it, Mike. Think about it. Meditate on it. Study it. Ponder it. Make notes on it. Ask me questions. But read that text, people. Okay? You'll have more fun reading it than you will counting it. And I'm not against counting it, but you'll have more fun reading it than counting it. That's what RNA polymerase does. And it makes, and I covered this Tuesday, it was where we left off, it makes this little strand here, the transcripted copy, is called messenger RNA. It's like a guy handing out tracts, or an angel speaking to Joshua, or the Lord speaking to Moses out of the fiery furnace, or Paul preaching in Mars Hill, or John giving us the book of Revelation. Whatever it is a messenger, an angel giving a message. That's what the scientists called it. I'm just going, they're right. They're dead on. They're giving script. They're passing scriptures out so that the body can live. Woo! I'm just a little bit happy with this stuff. Isaiah 22. And Jesus opened the book, right? He's the only one that can. Isaiah 22:22, and the key of the house of David will I lay upon his shoulder. By the way, I don't know if you know this or not. It said the key he would lay upon his shoulder. I don't know what all this means, but did you know, do you know what some of you who are in the medical profession or you just happen to know this from college or high school? What is this bone here from my right arm socket? From here coming over across my neck and back over to my other arm socket. What is that bone called? Anybody know? Anybody? Anybody? Susie, you know what it is? Johnny? Johnny? It's called a clavicle. You know what the word clavicle means? Key. You're going to look it up. Clavicle means key. And it's really the idea that the shoulder bones and your head or the neck and the spine makes what looks like a key. Okay? Don't know what all that means, but when it said the key, the house of David will I lay upon his shoulder, I'm going, yeah, okay, that's pretty cool because that's what your clavicle, that's why it's called that, because it looks like a key. So he shall open and none shall shut, and he shall shut and none shall open. Ask yourself the question, when Noah got on the ark, how did he shut the door? He didn't. God did. God's, and who opened the door? God was. God is the only one. Christ is the only one who can open something. And once he opens it, no man can shut it. Once he shuts something, no man can open it. It's that simple. CERN. And there's all these videos at CERN. And by the Ariel sent me some information I did not know. That apparently CERN is about ready to fire up again, and they have a new program, or they have a new experiment or whatever that they call. I got to cue the music on this one. They call it Awaken. And I want to see some information on that. But there's, I mean, there's all this, these garbage videos out on YouTube that are claiming that CERN is opening portals right now. They're opening the portals and these devils and the New World Order and everything. Listen to me. The only one in the whole universe that has the key is not CERN. It's Jesus. Now, in Revelation 9, in fact, let's go to Revelation 9. Open your Bible up. Let's read it. And while you're doing that, Revelation 3:7, to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write, these things saith he that is holy, that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. Isaiah was prophesying of Jesus Christ. Revelation 9, since we know. I mean, we've just set a fact here in motion. We know for a fact, an undisputed account given to you in your Bible, that if it's a locked door and it needs a key, Christ is the only one who opens or has the key. It looks like in Revelation 9, and we know, and look at the language. A fifth angel sounded, or the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. Who had the key? Christ did. What did he do with it? The devil didn't steal it. CERN didn't perform the correct ritual. The Pentagon did not align the Stargate symbols correctly. Jesus gave this falling star, which we know is an angel. It's a spirit, a being. Jesus gave this angel the key. What? And probably didn't even have to say, now I'm going to give you this key. And whatever you do, don't open that portal down there. And whatever you do, don't open it soon now. He probably didn't have to say anything. God designed this star. My personal belief is this is Lucifer. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? And here we have a star fall from heaven. And it's the fifth trumpet. And Lucifer says five things in Isaiah 14. I think it's Lucifer. Okay? Doesn't say it. It's what I think. But anyway, he designed whatever spirit this is was already designed that once it gets the key, it's going to do what it's going to do. I was holding my grandson Roland the other day, and I was just marveling at how babies grow. And he was getting kind of restless. Lisa wasn't ready quite yet to take him and feed him whatever. So I was just holding him. Grandpas don't have to change the diapers and feed the babies no more. Grandpas can just play with them and then go do something. So I was holding him, and he got a little restless, so I just reached over on the coffee table, and I grabbed one of those baby bottle toppers, you know, those plastic lids, and I just stuck it right in front of his hand, and immediately because I knew what he was going to do. He's at the age where you put it in front of him, he's going to grab it, he's going to feel it, twist it around, and then stick it in his mouth, and that is exactly what he did. I didn't have to tell him to do that. I just knew he was going to do it. Because that's the way, at his age, that's what he does. That's what babies do at that age. They're programmed that way. All of them do that. And this star falls, and it's already, Jesus knows what it's going to do. Immediately after like the 4 or 5 bounces that he makes on the earth from falling from heaven, he runs to the pit, wherever it is, sticks the key in the lock, and opens that thing up. And Jesus was not sitting up in heaven going, oh dear, what have I done? He knows exactly what he did. That's why he gave him the key to begin with. And that's why he's not been given the key yet. It's not time. Okay? But anyway, when it comes to this book, when it comes to the gates of hell, the door to the bottomless pit, when it comes to these things, Jesus is the only one who has the authority, the power, the will to open those things. Man can't. The biggest devils from hell or going to hell can't do it unless Jesus wills it, unless Jesus allows it. Revelation 5. Now we see the book. I saw on the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with 7 seals. Donna tells me she's got this working theory, and I like it. The hydrogen bonds. Let me illustrate it like right here. Here's the DNA. And like right down the middle here, there would be your base pairs. Adenine, guanine, or thymine here. Cytosine, guanine here. And there are hydrogen, which is what water is made from. So you think water. Hydrogen, it's like glue that are holding these two ends together. And her working theory, and I like it, she said on average, in like this 10 row, because there's 10 of these base pairs in one helical turn. Okay, like from here to here, there's 10 of these. And she said, on average, there's 7 types of these hydrogen bonds in here. And I'm going, okay, I'll take that. I sure will. I think it works. But anyway, those hydrogen bonds are the seals. They are unsealed by RNA polymerase. They are unwound, unrolled, read, transcripted, and then performed. Just like the Word of God. One of the elders saith unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the 7 seals thereof. Jesus is RNA polymerase, and on and on and on. I taught about this last week. Here's what happens. When the book, the seals begin to come off, one seal comes off. But when one seal comes off, all 4 of these horsemen don't come flying out. Why? It's just like in your DNA. It goes by sections and it goes in order. It's not time for the 4th horse yet. You got to have the first one come out first. That's another seal. I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, I heard as it were the noise of thunder, one of the 4 beasts saying, come and see. By the way, in the last couple nights, I haven't been able to sleep well. Somebody recommended to me that I go and watch the newest X-Men Apocalypse. By the way, let me help you with something. And I think the people who made this movie know this. The word apocalypse, it does not mean the destruction of the world. It does not mean a great cataclysm where dead bodies and smoke and busted up buildings are laying everywhere. It doesn't mean that. The meaning of the word apocalypse means to reveal, a revelation. That's what it means. And the movie was called X-Men Apocalypse, or X-Men Revelation. And of course, there's a evil X-Men rising up out of the pit with 4 four trainees, four disciples, four pupils, just like the four horsemen. And he rises up out of hell, rises up out of a pit. And the chief X-Men, Professor Xavier, whatever, he's the one that saves humanity and saves the world. And the next thing, I'm saying all this because the evil X-Men guy from the pit, when he's collecting his disciples, he said to Magneto, he said, "Come and see." And I'm going, I know that. That's from Revelation chapter 6. I just read that the other day. They were quoting the Bible. But at the end of the movie, I caught this. Professor Xavier is the guy who basically saves the entire world from being destroyed. And the next thing you hear is you see all these news helicopter videos showing, you know, the destruction has ended. There's pieces laying everywhere. And then a guy, you know, like in a radio or TV broadcast saying, "It must have been only by the grace of God that the destruction has stopped or the world has been saved." And I'm thinking, okay, this was done by one guy, Charles Xavier. Okay, there is a revelation here. And Charles Xavier has the ability to connect to the mind of every human being on the planet. He's a god. And to me, it's just the message that, yeah, there's bad guys out there. There's bad guys in every movie. But it'll be the genetically modified gods that are going to be the new saviors of this planet. Just like those four base pairs, once that hydrogen bond has been broken and that book is opened up and things in your body are made, things happen now. Prophecy is being fulfilled. This is what you see with four horsemen, four elements, four directions, four dimensions or whatever. "Come and see, and I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given on him. He went forth conquering and to conquer. When he opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, 'Come and see,' and there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another, and there was given unto him a great sword. When he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, 'Come and see,' and I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, 'A measure of wheat for a penny, three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil and the wine.' When he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, 'Come and see,' and I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed with him." Watch the movie Tombstone, Kurt Russell, okay? You'll get it. You'll see the scene, and I put this in the video from last week, the four horsemen. You'll see the scene of the four guys, okay? Wyatt Earp, his brother Virgil, his other brother Virgil, and then Doc Holliday walking down the street to the OK Corral, and behind them is hell. There's this huge building on fire, and a scene was set up to do exactly. They, at one point, the guys turn around to look at the fire. They draw your attention to it. Hell is following with them. Kurt Russell later on has got Ike Clanton down. He says, "You tell him I'm coming and hell's coming with me." Okay, that was the highlight of the movie. But the idea here is what you're seeing in Revelation is you're seeing what DNA does. There are things right now still sealed up in God's word that have not happened yet. Just as there are things in your body that have not been encoded yet, have not been transcripted and translated into something that goes into your body or something that does something into your body. Your body is this in this progressive state of things being unsealed and prophecies of your DNA being fulfilled. And that's the Bible, people. There are things latent in this book that are sealed up. But one of these days, the seals are going to be broken by Jesus, the polymerase machine. They're going to be opened up and they are going to be performed. Nehemiah, oh, I like this. This is like one of those foreshadows of Jesus opening. Look at this, Nehemiah chapter 8. And all the people gathered themselves together as what? One man. Isn't that cool? Into the street that was, see, and this is the good thing right here. This is the dry bones of Ezekiel 28. This is Israel. Now joining themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate, and they spake unto Ezra the scribe. By the way, a scribe, you know what he does? He transcripts scripture. That's what he does. Ezra the scribe is a RNA polymerase machine. He's a foreshadow of Jesus. To bring the book of the law of Moses, think of book, think of DNA, which the Lord had commanded Israel. And Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation, both of men and women, and all that could hear with understanding upon the first day of the seventh month. And he read therein before the street that was before the water gate from the morning until midday, before the men and the women and those that could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive unto the book of the law. And Ezra the scribe, I love this, stood upon a pulpit of wood, which they had made for the purpose. And beside him stood Mattathiah and Shema and Ananiah and Uriah and Hilkiah. That's my grandson's name. That's where it came from. And Maaseiah on his right hand, in his left hand, Padiah and Mishael and Malchiah and Hashum and Hashbadana and Zach. I would love to have a grandchild name. Hashbadana and Meshulam. It's like 14 people here. Look at verse 5. Look at verse 5. This is a prophecy right here. This right here is sealed up in God's treasures. It hasn't happened yet, but it's going to. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people. Look at that! Look at that! He was, where was he? He was above all the people. The Lord's appearing in the air and the clouds. He's going to be above all the people. And he opened, when he opened it all the people did what? They stood. You know what that means? They didn't fall. They did what Paul told us in Ephesians chapter 6, when that fourth kingdom starts doing their stuff in the evil day. They did what Paul said. Let me read this. I love this. I don't know if you can tell. I'm having more fun. I'm just going to tell Rose, our secretary, hold my check. You don't have to pay me this week. I'm eating this up. And wait till my wife finds out I did that. Ephesians chapter. I'm not belittling my wife. That woman paid our bills when I worked in construction and wasn't working in construction. My wife paid our bills. God used her. I know God did this, but I will say she is the reason why I'm even still here. She is. So anyway, how it works. I never see the paycheck. I never do. Rose doesn't bring me my paycheck and says, here you go. We're paying another week. That doesn't happen. Goes to Lisa. She takes it to the bank. She takes care of everything. I don't need anything. Finally, my brethren, verse 10, Ephesians chapter 6, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to what? Fall? Fall away? Be slain in the spirit? No. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand, therefore. How many times does it say stand? Paul said, stand fast in the liberty with Christ has made us free. And the grace in where you stand. not fall. And what happened? What happens to Israel? People, what is going to happen to Israel when the four winds of the gospel are blown into their nostrils? When the book that Jesus takes from the right hand of God, when the seals are broken and the hydrogen bonds are separated and the DNA book is unrolled and the RNA polymerase begins to transcribe and proclaim the word of the DNA book, the word of the Lord, Israel is going to stand when that book is open. You'll have pastors. I do this every now and then, but I'm not one of these guys that just says, now here's our key text, let's stand as we read God's word, and then I'm going to preach for 45 minutes and not mention any Bible verses. I just go verse. But I know some guys. Mike Hutzel does this, Reg Kelly does this. Other guys I know, when they have the reading of God's word, let's stand in reverence to God's word. And they get that from Nehemiah. Nehemiah is a prototype. It's a prophecy, people, and it's sealed up. It hasn't happened yet, but it's going to. And Ezra, verse 6, bless the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, amen, amen, with lifting up their hands. And they must all turn Pentecostal. Amen, somebody, woo, woo. And they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. And Jeshua and Bani and Sherebiah and Jamin and Akub and Shebathiah and Hodijah and Messiah and Kalida and Azariah and Josabad and Hanan and Peliah and the Levites caused the people. There's a guy. It's been bugging me for years. He called me one day and he said, man, he said, you're doing right in that King James Bible. I said, well, thank you. And he said, but your preaching's all wrong. I said, well, I'm sorry you don't like it. He said, it's not a matter of like. He said, you don't preach your words. You're singing in your church service. That's all wrong. That's unbiblical. God's not honored by that. He said, you're only supposed to sing the Bible. You're only supposed to preach the words of God, the Bible, not anything else. When you give your words, you're dishonoring God. And I said, I do not agree with that. No, sir, I do not. The Apostle Peter on the day of Pentecost, yes, he read or he quoted from the book of Joel. He said, this is that which was spoken by the prophets saying, and he gave the text, but then he did this. Watch this. These Levites caused the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place. So they read in the book of the law of God distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. That's what God's men are required to do. That's what I'm doing 8 times a week, if I can get by with it. I'm not just standing here quoting scripture. I'm giving you the sense of it and causing you to understand the reading of it as best as I can. Now, am I going to say everything right? No. Am I going to make mistakes in my understanding? Yeah. Am I a man that I should lie? Absolutely. God is not. That's why I tell you, don't just take my word for it. You go back and study it out yourself. You read the word of God. He didn't like my answer. Here's messenger RNA. Preach the word. For the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Let me change keys here, because I'm going to have to cut out a little early today. Let's see here. Which one do I want to give you? This one right here. I found out something today. And it's related to what we just learned about RNA polymerase. And here's Jesus, and he finds the right place in the book of Isaiah. He reads the certain words And then he stops. He stops making the protein. He stops fulfilling where the scripture is. And he closes the book again. And in this video that I posted, it got my attention because it said that certain things like herpes hijacks and hides in our cells. So that got my attention because it's like there's the words of God, the DNA, and then herpes is a virus. And a virus, really all it is it's like in a shell, in a protective coating, capsule, alien capsule landing in your body. And it contains in it a secret code. And it doesn't want the body to find out that it's there. Now, the virus has the ingredients of what it wants to make in your body, but it doesn't have the mechanism to make it with. It's just like a cookbook sitting on the shelf. Until grandma or mom picks up the cookbook, begins to read the ingredients and the instructions, and then begins to do those things. See, this is why we're told to be doers of the word and not hearers only, because your DNA does that. Your body does that. It doesn't just read the Bible. It translates it. It interprets it. It does what that Bible says to do. This is what we're supposed to be doing, people. And I can say, I know this. We're created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Once God puts the word in our hearts, you know what I believe? He's the one that performs it in us. Okay? But viruses, they have the ingredients. They just don't have the way to put it together. So watch this. Here's this alien ship called Herpes. Let me get down here. You know, when the RNA polymerase is scanning the DNA, it's looking for a start and a stop codon. It's looking for a segment of DNA. And once it hits that, it either starts transcribing or it stops transcribing because it's reached the point where that gene ends. There's no more. So here's what it says. Viruses are not like cells. They have DNA, but no machinery. They survive by inserting their DNA into the DNA of host cells so that instead of making proteins for the cell machinery makes virus proteins and copies of the virus. Think Hebrew roots. Think Jehovah's Witness. Think Mormons. Let's take Roman Catholicism or Mormons. Think of, this will be easy. Think of Mormons as a virus. Think of the Book of Mormon as a virus. They want to bring, these Mormon missionaries want to bring the Book of Mormon into your collective consciousness and get you to accept it. But they can't make you do it because it's foreign. It's not part of what you already think or know. They can't make you do it. So every cult, and I mean every cult, does the same thing. They come in stealthily, encapsulated, hidden, to where you can't easily detect it at first. And then what their whole goal is to get to where they can inject their false DNA doctrine into just one cell. Because once they do, that RNA polymerase now is going to be tricked into making the virus wants to build but can't do itself, and then it's going to be tricked into dividing and making more virus cells. That's how the Mormons did it. The Jehovah's Witness, United Pentecostals, Roman Catholics. That's how all the cults work. Bring in false doctrines. By the way, how many virus pores does your body need to take in order for you to end up with that virus? One, two, three. Think of that virus as leaven. Because leaven and virus, actually, they're kind of the same. When you have a packet of yeast in your fridge, basically, you're looking at these little shells that are, and those things can last as long as they're dry. They can last for years, forever, I guess, as long as those shells remain intact. But once those shells dissolve by water, I guess, or heat or whatever, then that yeast or that leaven in there, that packet of DNA, can go and do what it's designed to do. And it's a little leaven, leaveneth the whole lump. Jesus told us that leaven was like the doctrine of who? The Hebrew roots, the Pharisees, or the cults. It's their doctrine. You know what the Jews did? You know what the rabbis, the mystics, sages, that all the Hebrew roots people follow after? You know what they did? They're not giving you the law. They're not giving you the Torah. They're not giving you what Moses brought down from Mount Sinai. They're giving you the viruses that were added to it. The Mishnah and the Midrash and the Tanakh and the Zohar. They're giving you the virus doctrines, the leaven doctrines, but they're not giving you the real word of God in the law. So watch this. Within a few hours of invading a host cell, HSV-1, which is herpes simplex virus 1, has seized the protein-making machine and is producing its own proteins and copies of itself on a massive scale. The new study investigates in detail how HSV-1 manages to do this and evade detection by the immune system, which normally spots cells behaving abnormally and kills them before they can do too much damage. That's your white blood cells, by the way. That's Jesus. Destroying anything that violates your body. The study team used cultures of fibroblast. I won't read all that. The research has found that within 4 hours of entering the cell, the herpes simplex virus does something quite unexpected. Usually, the process of transcribing the DNA into RNA stops when it reaches the end of the gene. A section of code that marks the end of the gene tells the transcription process to stop. But in a host cell controlled by herpes simplex virus, the transcription process ignores those end codes and goes on, blindly transcribing from DNA into RNA thousands of irrelevant sections of adenine, cytosine, guanine, and thymine code, sometimes from neighboring genes. The result is masses of unusable RNA products that cannot be translated into proteins. Meanwhile, virus proteins are transcribed perfectly. Another interesting discovery is that although the host DNA is transcribed into nonsense, it transcribes the viral DNA perfectly throughout infection. Are you catching this? Basically, what it's saying is the virus gets in to the DNA strand and causes, it just takes out the stop codon. You know what the stop codon is? The stop codon is Revelation 22, where Jesus said, "This is it. The Bible's done. There are no more words added. None. Stop right here." That's what Jesus said in Revelation 22. No more. The virus removes the stop codon so that there is this idea that new doctrines can be added. new verses can be brought down. Another chapter, John chapter 22. Remember that? Remember Sid Soth talking to that guy? Said that Jesus showed him a book called John chapter 22 and said, one of these days I'm going to bring you back up here and I'm going to let you bring that book down and show the world what I said in that book, and they're going to accept it and it's going to transform the world. Are you kidding me? People, man, this stuff makes sense now, doesn't it? That's how the cults work. They get you to think that there are more words, that the revelation and what Jesus said doesn't matter. The stop codon's not there anymore. More words are going to be added. New coming down from heaven. God's given us new revelations and new doctrines and a new gospel. That's what a virus does. And viruses, they don't make us better. They always make us worse. People, we're living in the virus age. All the new doctrines, all the signs and wonders, and all the different movements, ministry movements, church movements that are going on, bowel movements that are going on in churches, all these new things that are coming in is setting up churches just like the virus to remove the stop codon out of the end of the Bible so that people accept the new seed. They shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. That's what viruses do. This is the era of it right now. We just entered into the very, very early stages of the New World Order. Are you ready? Just a couple things I'll tell you today. It's very simple. Pray, read your Bible. Pray, read your Bible. Pray, read your Bible. Pray some more, read your Bible some more. Take a break. Hey, read your Bible. I love you. Pray for our ministry. If you're not doing anything Sunday, why don't you join us for church? If you can't make it here, watch BethelChurch.com Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. We would love to have you with us, worshiping with us online. Pray for our radio ministry. We got the signal yesterday. Woo! Amen! Won't be long. Pray for all that we do here. The devil hates us. Hell hates us. They'll hate you too if you're on Jesus' side. All right? Love you. See you Sunday.